Gopi Jana Vallabha Giri Varadari Gopi Jana Vallabha Jashoda Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana Yashoda Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana Yamuna Tihe Ramana Chari Yamuna Tihe Ramana Chari Jayo Radha Madhava Kunjabi Hari Radha Jayo Radha Madhava Kunjabi Hari Radha Madhava Gopi Jana Vallabha Giri Varadari Gopi Jana Vallabha Gopi Jana Vallabha Giri Varadari Gopi Jana Vallabha Jashoda Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana Jashoda Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana Jamuna Tihe Ramana Chari Yamuna Tira Manachari Jayo Radha Madhava Kunjabi Hari 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 Radha Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna. Jaya Prabhupada, 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 Srila Prabhupada. Nitai Gaura Haribo, 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 Gaura Haribo. Skan founder Acharya Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. BBT founder Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Namacharya Srila Haridas Thakur Ki Jai. Prem Segaho Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nichananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shivazadi Gaura Bhaktivinoda Ki Jai. Shri Shri Radha Krishna Gopa Gopinath Shamakund Radha Kund Agiri Govardhana Ki Jai. Shri Vrindavan Dham Ki Jai. Mayapur Navadvip Dham Ki Jai. Ganga Mai Ki Jai, Jamuna Mai Ki Jai, Tulsi Devi Ki Jai, Bhakti Devi Ki Jai, the most beautiful lordship, Shishi Radha Landanishwara Ki Jai, Jagannath Baladev Subhadra Maharani Ki Jai, Agiriraj Maharaj Ki Jai, Shishi Gorni Tai Ki Jai, Harinam Sankirtan Ki Jai, Sankirtan Yagya Ki Jai, Brihad Madanga Transcendental Book Distribution Ki Jai, Nitai Golda Premanandi. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the lotus feet of Sri Guru and Sri Gauranga. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Hare Krishna, everyone. So thank you all very much for attending the Srimad Bhagavatam class. There's very rare souls who hear from the holy scriptures and texts so early in the morning these days. So I would like to congratulate and express my gratitude and appreciation to all of you for your strong desire to hear from the scriptures at such an early hour of the morning. So today we'll be continuing our reading from the Granthraj Srimad Bhagavatam, 10th canto, chapter 84, which is entitled The Sage's Teachings at Kurukshetra. And we'll be reading a number of verses today, starting with text 42, I think it is. Thanks for starting with text 42. Yeah, and then we'll go up to text 41. So if someone could, Vayu Prabhu, maybe you can man the iPad. It's here, it's all ready to go, just there's no human intervention with it at this stage. So before we begin, I would like to seek blessings from all of the assembled Vaishnavas that you see fit to bestow your mercy upon me so that I can speak something both bona fide and relevant from the pages of this exalted scripture, Srimad Bhagavatam. Only by the mercy of Vaishnavas is anything possible. Hare Krishna. So before we begin, we will recite the invocation. So if everyone can please repeat. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. So, starting with text 42 of the 10th canto, chapter 84. I will just read the English, and then we will repeat verse 51 together. Shukadeva Goswami said, after hearing these statements of the sages, generous Vasudev bowed his head to the ground and, praising them, requested them to become his priests. Thus requested by him, O King, the sages engaged the pious Vasudev in performing fire sacrifices at the holy place of Kurukshetra, according to the strict religious principles and with most excellent ritual arrangements. When Maharaj Vasudev was about to be initiated for the sacrifice, O King, the Vrishnis came to the initiation pavilion after bathing and putting on fine clothes and garlands of lotuses. The other kings also came, elaborately ornamented, as well as all their joyful queens who wore jeweled lockets around their necks and were also clad in fine garments. The royal wives were anointed with sandalwood paste and carried auspicious items for worship. Mridangas, patahas, conch shells, bedis, anakas, and other instruments resounded. Male and female dancers danced, and sutas and magadas recited glorifications. Sweet-voiced Gandharvis sang, accompanied by their husbands. After Vasudev's eyes had been decorated with black cosmetic and his body smeared with fresh butter, the priests initiated him according to scriptural rules by sprinkling him and his 18 wives with sacred water. Encircled by his wives, he resembled the regal moon encircled by stars. Purport. Devaki was Vasudev's principal wife, but she had several co-wives, including her six sisters. This fact is recorded in the 9th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam. Devaka Grinj Senas Cha Chatwaro Devakt Matjaha Devan Upadevas Cha Sudevo Devavardanaha Tesham Swasara Shaptasan Dritta Deva Dayon Ripa Shanti Devo Padeva Cha Shrideva Devar Devarakshitaha Sahadeva Deviki Cha Vasudeva Uvahataha. Ahuka had two sons named Devika and Ugrasen. Devika had four sons named Devavan, Upadev, Sudev, and Devardhan, Devavardhana. And he also had seven daughters named Shantidev, Upadev, Shridev, Devarakshita, Sahadeva, Devaki, and Dhritadeva. Dhritadeva was the eldest. Vasudev, the father of Krishna, married all these sisters. Some of Vasudev's other wives are mentioned a few verses later. Poravi Rohini Badra Madira Rochana Ila Devaki Pramukashchasan Patnya Anakadandbehe. Devaki, Poravi, Rohini, Badra, Madira, Rochana, Ila, and others were all wives of Anakadandubi, Vasudev. Among them all, Devaki was the chief. Text 48. Vasudev received initiation along with his wives, who wore silk saris and were adorned with bangles, necklaces, ankle bells, and earrings. With his body wrapped in a deer skin, Vasudev shone splendidly. My dear Maharaj Parikshit, Vasudev's priests and the officiating members of the assembly, dressed in silk dhotis and jeweled ornaments, looked so effulgent that they seemed to be standing in the sacrificial arena of Indra, the killer of Vritra. Text 50. At that time, Balaram and Krishna, the lords of all living entities, shone forth with great majesty in the company of their respective sons, wives, and other family members, who were expansions of their opulences. And then today's verse, text 51. Please repeat. Ijenu yagyam vidina Agnihotradi lakshanai Prakriter vaikriter yagyar Dravyajnana kriyeshwaram Ijenu yagyam vidina Agnihotradi lakshanai Prakriter vakritar yagyar Dravyajnana kriyeshwaram Ijenu yagyam vidina Agnihotradi lakshanai Prakriter vakriter yagyar Dravyajnana kriyeshwaram Someone else, please. Gentlemen. Ladies, please. any other brave souls? Jai Shishi Radha Londoneshwar Ki Jai Giri Govardhan Shishi Gorni Tai Ki Jai. Translation and purport by the disciples of His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Sorry, let's do the word for word. E.J. He worshipped Anuyagyam with each kind of sacrifice. Vidina. By the proper regulations. Agnihotra. By offering oblations into the sacred fire. Adi. And so on. Lakshanai. Characterized. Prakritahai. Unmodified. Completely specified by Shruti injunctions. Prakritai, modified, adjusted according to the indications of other sources. Yagyai, with sacrifices. Dravya, of the sacrificial paraphernalia. Jnana, of the knowledge of mantras. Kriya, and of the rituals. Ishwaram, the Lord. Translation and purport by the disciples of His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Performing various kinds of Vedic sacrifice according to the proper regulations, Vasudev worshipped the Lord of all sacrificial paraphernalia, mantras, and rituals. He executed both primary and secondary sacrifices according to oblations to the sacred fire and carrying out other aspects of sacrificial worship. Purport. There are numerous kinds of Vedic fire sacrifice, each of which involves several elaborate rituals. The Brahmana portion of the Vedic Shruti specifies the complete step-by-step procedure of only a few prototype sacrifices, such as the Jyotish Toma and the Darsha Purnamasa. These are called the Prakrita or original yajñas. The details of other yajñas must be extrapolated from the patterns of these Prakrita injunctions according to the strict rules of the Mimamsa Shastra. Since the other yajñas are thus known by derivation from the prototype sacrifices, they are called Vikrita, or changed. Om Ajnanatimirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshuram Militangena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobishtam Stapitam Gena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Gurun Shri Yuta Parakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Sri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Sri Vishakanvitamscha He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Jagatpate Gopisha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurange Radhe Brindavanishwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpa Tarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhyevacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shivas Adi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare Text 51 again. Ijenu yagyam vidhina agni hotradi lakshanai prakriter vikritar yagyar dravya jnana kriyeshwaram. Performing various kinds of Vedic sacrifice according to the proper regulations, Vasudev worshipped the Lord of all sacrificial paraphernalia, mantras, and rituals. He executed both primary and secondary sacrifices, offering oblations to the sacred fire and carrying out other aspects of sacrificial worship. Okay, so let's see what we have going on here is many activities, many things happening. Specifically for Vasudev, it appears that he's about to do what? Or what is he doing? Get initiation. Okay, very nice, interesting. Anything else? Initiation into what? Okay. There is a silence amongst the crowd, so let's go back and put this whole thing into proper context because we might not, over the last 3 or 4 days, been able to keep up. So everyone remembers that they're on the battlefield of Kurukshetra. Of course, at this stage, it's not a battlefield as such. It's actually the holy place of the Dharmakshetra, Kurukshetra. So this place of pilgrimage, they've all gathered. Who's present? Who's present? The most important person? Krishna and Balaram are both present. It's during the eclipse time, and all the residents of Dwarka and all the residents of Vrindavan, or at least many of them, let's not say all, but many of them have come and they've gathered together specifically for the opportunity to have the darshan of Krishna. And it's also a bit of a family or community reunion. So all the Dwarka Basis and all the Braj Basis are able to mix and mingle. Of course, Vasudeva and Nanda Maharaj are able to come together. And these great sages have also come. They're there. And as they're about to leave the assembly, Vasudeva goes and approaches them. And he recognizes that, now I have this wonderful opportunity to ask a question of the great sages, which we discussed before is what all of us should do, take the opportunity, any opportunity of the association of great souls. We should tadvidi prani patena pari prashnena sevya upadekshanti te jnanam, that we should inquire submissively. So Vasudev inquires submissively from the sages. He offers so much respect and appreciation to them, and then he asks a question. Anyone remember the question? Okay, so the question that he asked was, he said, "O great sages, please kindly tell us how the reactions of one's work can be counteracted by further work." Okay, so this is one of those questions that if we first understand the question, what is Vasudeva asking? What is he basically asking? How to get free from karmic reactions by continuing with karma. Karma means activities. So how do I get free from my karmic reactions but still continue to do some activity by doing some other activity? Okay, so in one sense, you know, from the bhakti perspective, this seems to be almost a little bit of a kind of, maybe we could say, mundane question. But actually, Vasudeva is asking on behalf of everyone, how am I meant to get free from the reactions of my previous deeds by the performance of deeds now? What am I meant to do? Of course, the Gita explains so much that we can't not do anything. We have to do something. So all of us are doing something. So he asked the sages, and their response is that it's definitely concluded that the work is counteracted by further work when one executes Vedic sacrifices as a means of worshipping Vishnu, the Lord of all sacrifice, with sincere faith. So Tad Vigyan Artham, what is it? Tad Vishnu. Ooh. Third chapter. Can someone get me a Gita? Yes. What's the Sanskrit? Tad. Tad Vishnu. Yeah. Yagyata Karmano Vishnu Lokuyam Vandanaha. Tadartam Karma Kuntaya Mukta Sangha Samacharaha. Right? Yeah. So, work done as a sacrifice for Vishnu has to be performed. Otherwise, work causes bondage in this material world. So, our activities have to be done as a sacrifice to Krishna, to the Lord, to Vishnu. So, this is what the sages say. Then they say to Vasudeva, "My dear Prabhu, a member of the twice-born class is born with three kinds of debts." Now, at this point, we should understand that they're speaking directly to Vasudeva, and they're talking to him. So they're saying a member of the twice-born class. What does that mean, twice-born class? Brahminical class. So that means that Vasudeva is already twice initiated. He's already brahminically initiated. Now, Vasudeva is... Varna is Vasudeva? He's Kshatriya. So can a Kshatriya be twice born? Yes. Kshatriyas can also be twice born. So, because earlier we mentioned that he's about to get initiated, but we should first understand that he's already twice initiated. Okay? Just to put that into context and perspective. So they say that actually those who are twice born, they're born with three kinds of debts. Debts, D-E-B-T-S, debts, means you owe something. Anyone remember what those three debts are? Who they owe? Debts to the forefathers, to the pitras, right? Or pitris, yeah? And debts to the great sages, and debts to the demigods. So, we're born with three debts: demigods, sages, and forefathers. Just quickly, why is there some debt to the demigods? What are they doing for us? Yeah, basically, they're supplying us with everything: sun, air, earth, moon, you know, water, fire. So without at least those basic items, what could you do? scratch your head. You can't even scratch your head because there's demigods who are controlling all of the different senses. So the devatas, in one sense, they're providing and supplying everything. So there's a debt to them. The sages, why is there a debt to the sages? Spiritual knowledge. They've given wisdom. So they've given us the knowledge. Otherwise, where did this come from? Right? So who was the sage who compiled the Srimad Bhagavatam? Srila Vyasadeva. So we're indebted. Inside of the pages of the Bhagavatam, who's speaking now to Vasudeva? The sages. So the sages are giving this knowledge. So we're indebted to the sages. And to the Pitris, to the forefathers, why are we indebted? They gave us this life. So we wouldn't be here if it wasn't for them. Of course, that might be an argument for maybe not appreciating them, but we were going to have to come here anyway. So, so our birth into this world has been given by the forefathers. And if in a cultured environment, also the forefathers would have helped to prepare us in such a in a nice way so that we've actually got a good opportunity for making spiritual progress and advancement in this lifetime. Does that make sense? So, but of course in Kali Yuga things are a little bit different. But that's those are the debts. So the sages also explain, or I think it's in the purport, that verse from the Vedas describes how these different personalities are satisfied by how we repay those debts. Does anyone remember how we repay the debts of the sages? Anyone? Celibacy, yes. So by the performance of celibacy, then one repays the debts. Because the devatas, or because the sages say to Vasudeva, you're already free from the debts of two of these. You're already free from two of these debts, but you have one debt outstanding. Okay? Everyone still with me? No? You're not with me? Okay. Where did we lose you? Okay. Up to that point, are you still with me? Okay. All right. So he is only in debt to one personality. He's paid off two of them. He's paid off the sages, and he's paid off the forefathers. He paid off the sages by celibacy. Now, this might be a little complicated because we just heard he's got 16 wives, right? So, hey, you know. Celibacy comes in all shapes and sizes. Celibacy also because procreation, you know, for the purpose of begetting children, you know, within the sanctity and the atmosphere of marriage is also considered celibacy. Okay? So he's paid off with that sense control and celibacy. He's also paid off the forefathers. How has he paid off the forefathers? By begetting children. And what children did he beget? Who are his children? Krishna and Balaram. I mean, you can't ask for better children than that. As naughty as they are, right? But still, he's produced such exalted children. So who is he indebted to still? The demigods. And how do you repay the debt to the demigods? By sacrifice, swaha. So this is why they're talking to him about performing Vedic sacrifice. And they're saying that you can repay your karma, your karmic activities, you know, you can justify them by performing these rites, these rituals. So like that. They discuss about initiation. Now, it was nice. A few of you picked up on the fact that initiation was discussed. So, if he's already twice born, if he's already twice initiated, if he's already brahminically initiated, then what type of initiation is happening here? Because it says, I think, three or four times, you know, he's about to receive initiation. His wives are going to get initiated. So what is the initiation that's happening here? An upanaya is usually brahminical initiation, right? Nice. Very nice. Okay. So like that, often we would understand, you know, means when you're a young man and from Brahminical class, you would get the thread and be initiated. But the point is that you're initiated into mantras that enables you to perform sacrifice. Diksha, and because the term that's actually used in the Sanskrit here is also diksha. So diksha comes from two words in Sanskrit. It's broken into two syllables, di and sha. So di comes from dan, which means to give wealth of spiritual knowledge. And sha means from the Sanskrit sha, like kshatriya, which means to destroy. Means to destroy sinful propensities, to destroy sin, basically. So this word diksha means that you're initiated with, you're given spiritual knowledge with which you can destroy sinful reaction. So he's basically being initiated, he's being given diksha to perform these Vedic rites, to perform these Vedic rituals, to perform yajna or sacrifice. Makes sense? Still with me? Boring yet? Yeah? Oh, sorry about that. So now, one might begin to question, why is Vasudev going to perform Vedic rituals to the demigods? I thought that wasn't what we're meant to do, right? Okay, so for that, we will skip over to the Bhagavad Gita. So it's very nice because this is there to be understood. But first, let us understand what is explained in the Gita by Krishna and Srila Prabhupada's purports to the principle of performing fruitive activities because you can perform Vedic rituals, you can perform sacrifice for the purpose of material aspirations. And most persons who would follow Vedic culture, there's the verse, Triveda Vishya, Trigunya Vishya Veda Nishtrigunya Bhavarjuna Nirdwando Nicha Satvasto Nir Yoga Kshema Atmavan. That the Vedas deal mainly with the three modes of material nature. And Krishna asks Arjuna to become transcendental to these three modes and be free from all dualities. So before that, verses 42 and 43 says that men of small knowledge are very much attached to the flowery words of the Vedas, which recommend various fruitive activities for elevation to the heavenly planets, resultant good birth, power, and so forth. Being desirous of sense gratification and opulent life, they say that there is nothing more than this. So what is the point? That the Vedas primarily are dealing with the karma kanda. And what is the point of that? Because they're teaching persons how to become elevated from animalistic life to the human platform and ultimately to transcend and return moksha, liberation from the material world, to return to the spiritual kingdom. The difficulty is that people get hung up in performing activities just to get something good, like karma, good karma. So they perform yajnas, sacrifices, to get something out of it. That's not a problem in a sense, because at least by doing that, you're creating some piety and you're associating generally with Brahmins. You're offering some yajna, some sacrifice. Actually, it's described that even in the offering of worship to devatas, any Brahmin who would come to your house to perform a havan or a homa, they would first still have to invoke who? Vishnu. So all worship, even to the devatas, has to go through Vishnu, because the fire is the mouth of Vishnu. So, and all sacrifices going to him. So like that, it means that, and the mantras often are also referring to Vishnu, praise of Vishnu, like that. So by doing that pious activity, they're still getting the association of Brahmanas and the association of Vishnu, and they're still worshiping the Lord in as Krishna also says in the Bhagavad Gita, they worship me, but in a wrong way. So they're still worshiping him, but it's kind of an indirect way. So there's, in one sense, there's no problem with that. So Vasudeva is about to perform this worship, and here in these purports, Srila Prabhupada explains that you know, it's better to perform these types of worship than not. But in the age of Kali, the elaborate performance of Vedic rituals, and especially the offering of fire yajna, is very difficult and very complex. I mean, in those days, we were reading how everyone is dressed. You know, how everything is so elaborate. You know, it's called a sacrifice. And what does that mean? It means you give up something that you think is yours for the higher purpose of the worship of the Lord. So in Vedic sacrifice, you know, if we can get a bowl of ghee this big, you know, and the ladle is that big, and we pour a little bit in, you know, if we can keep it like that, then it's, you know, I was recently at a wedding, and, you know, the Brahmin was, you know, pouring the ghee, and then the manager of the facility started coming and saying, can you turn the fire off? You know, it's getting too big. The fire alarm's going to go off. And you know, it's like, how do you turn the fire off, my friend? You know, we're in the middle of a yajna here. And he's like, I don't care, just turn it down. You know, like he wants us to, you know, turn the vine. And, you know, the fire wasn't even that big. But at these big, you know, in this age, they were pouring, you know, they were pouring so much ghee into the fire. If anyone here purchases ghee, how much is ghee? You know? And this is good ghee, you know, this. So they're just pouring it into the fire, and so much fruit, so much grain, everything is being sacrificed. Everyone's dressed to the topmost, so much decoration, so much Lakshmi and wealth is being spent and sacrificed for the pleasure of Vishnu, for the pleasure of the Lord. So the question is, why is Vasudeva doing this? Because actually, as Srila Prabhupada explains, that it's very elaborate and very difficult, and generally, devotees wouldn't need to perform such sacrifices, because such rituals are generally meant for attached grihasthas. So for persons who are actually attached, then it's recommended that they go through the formal process. It's kind of like the ladder. But for devotees generally, as Prabhupada also describes in one of the purports here, if I can just find it again. Yeah, he explains here. Yeah, Srila Prabhupada explains that that in the age of Kali it's very difficult. So what is the process for us of performing sacrifice to Krishna, to the Lord? Chanting. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So he explains that in this age, Kali Yuga, for us to sacrifice by chanting is just like the sacrifices, the big yajnas that were performed. And Prabhupada quotes one verse from the Bhagavatam that says, O my Lord, a person who is chanting your holy name, although born in a low family like that of a chandala, dog eater, is situated on the highest platform of self-realization. Everyone still with me? Still awake? So one who is chanting the holy name, even if they're born in a family of dog eaters, is situated on the highest level of self-realization. So this person is the topmost person, even if they're born in a family of dog eaters. Such a person must have performed all kinds of penances and sacrifices according to the Vedic rituals and studied the Vedic literature many, many times after taking his bath in all the holy places of pilgrimage. So he's saying that Basically, a person who's chanting the holy name, even if born in a family of dog eaters, that person is on the highest level of self-realization and has certainly already performed so much austerity, offered so many, you know, yajnas, studied the Vedic literatures repeatedly, and taken bath many times in all the sacred rivers to be able to chant the holy name of the Lord. And then this verse says, such a person is considered to be the best of the Aryan family. So in Kali Yuga, to be chanting the holy name of the Lord, Harinam, Harinam, Harinam eva kevalam, Glaunashteva nashteva nashteva gatiranyata, Harinam, Harinam, Harinam eva kevalam, Glaunashteva nashteva nashteva gatiranyata, that this chanting of the holy name, this is the only way. This is the process that's given in this age for spiritual perfection. So in Vasudeva's situation, the reason that he's doing this is to set the example to others. Who else set the example by doing such things? Krishna himself sets the example. Every morning he rises, he chants his Gayatri mantra, meditates on himself. Lord Ram, he also performed worship, right? They all took initiation, diksha. You know, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself, he comes as the Lord, and in Kali Yuga, he sets the example and initiates the dharma of this age of Kali by chanting the holy names. So in this way, even the Lord himself, when he comes, he sets the example. So in this sense, Vasudeva is also setting the example. So like that. Anyway, there are other points that could be made, but we're a bit over time. Anyone has a question or comment or correction or chastisement? Yes, Mother, you will chastise? Oh, okay. Is there a microphone? Get on the mic, Mike, get on the mic.
Hare Krishna. Thank you. Nice class. I just was wondering if you knew why Srila Prabhupada established this procedure of doing fire sacrifices for like weddings and initiations, because many times he's said and stressed in his books how in this age Harinam saying the Sankirtan Yajna is really the only Yajna, and the installation of Krishna Balaram Vrindavan, he said, we don't really need to do this. We could have just chanted the holy name. But, you know, do you know why he did that?
Yeah. I mean, I don't know if I can profess to know exactly why, like Prabhupada didn't tell me why. But what I've understood is that it's the same also with deity worship. In a sense, he's went around the world installing deities for unqualified people in one sense to worship them, you know. And to the levels of deity worship that were stated in the beginning, you know, Prabhupada said that we should learn from the devotees at the Radharaman temple and like that, how to improve and increase, to go on increasing our deity worship. Same with fire yajnas. As far as I've understood that, also, Lord Chaitanya took bits of each of the sampradayas and molded them into kind of the Gaudiya Vaishnav like teachings. Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur continued that in such a way that ultimately there would be one Vedic practice that could encompass and satisfy persons from all of those different sampradayas. Now, especially from the Sri Sampradaya, this Vedic sacrifice and also deity worship are both there. So Srila Prabhupada was more or less following the Acharyas, following his Guru Maharaj, who also used that process. He talked also about samskaras all the time, but yet Prabhupada just gave the basics of that, in hopes that by planting the seed, that in the future, which now we see that is growing and being fructified, That these things would grow and develop, and we would be able to come to the platform of understanding and knowing how to do all these things, if not perfectly, but at least, you know, perfected it in some way. And it seems that it is an aspect of Vedic culture that should or could or needs to be there. You know, as far as for most of the samskaras require the lighting of fire and the offering of sacrifice. So these things are there. Srila Prabhupada also did them in a very simple way. When he performed the marriage ceremonies, he would generally, as far as I've understood, mostly chant the Mangalacharanam and offer the ghee. He wasn't chanting so many of the Vedic mantras and doing all the mudras and, you know, tantras and everything else. You know, he kept it very simple, but it was there. It's also, samskara means deep impression. And I don't know if anyone else has had that experience, but as soon as someone lights a fire in a room and starts chanting mantras, it's like, it makes a bit of a deep impression, you know? And, I mean, apart from the fact that you're obviously what is actually occurring, but it creates an intensity in the situation that definitely leaves a deep impression. So, you know, my understanding is that from the previous acharyas, from Lord Chaitanya, from his Guru Maharaj, that these things were done, and he carried that forward, and there are obviously parts of the Vedic culture that should be there, and in one sense, they may not need to be there, because in Kali Yuga, all we'd have to do is chant the holy names. But in our practice, deity worship should always be accompanied by the chanting of the holy names. Everything that we do, all of our activities are accompanied by the chanting also. So it's not that we ever leave that out, but anything else that we do in addition. And by the chanting, then, you know, whatever imperfections are there, is kind of like at the end of deity worship, after, like, when you do worship, at the end, if you offer a flower and you chant one mantra that's like, so, even though I've made so many mistakes, but with this one flower, please, you know, whatever I didn't offer, whatever I didn't do correctly, please allow it all to be offered with this one flower. So, like that, you know, the idea is that by chanting the holy names and taking shelter of the Lord, whatever imperfections may have been there, then, like that. So that was a very not good answer, but I don't know if that satisfied you in any way, or if you have some understanding yourself.
Are there any, do you know of any instances where you said Lord Chaitanya wanted to integrate the four sampradayas. Are there any instances where Lord Chaitanya or his direct followers did fire sacrifices?
I can't think of one offhand specifically. I don't know if anyone else can. But there's the book by Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, The Four Sampradayas. He speaks about these things in there, how Lord Chaitanya took different bits, because he took two bits of philosophy, I think, from each of the sampradayas and amalgamated them together. And then more or less it was like Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur who kind of, you know, he introduced certain aspects that would help to bring those sampradayas also together. So, like that. But I can't think actually of any specific incidences where they were offering fire yajnas or anything like that.
It may also be a way that, you know, devotees from other sampradayas recognize that, you know, the initiations and the ceremonies that we perform in ISKCON are bona fide according to their standard.
Yeah, that was the point.
That was the principle, Krishna Balaramanda.
Because eventually, at least the way I've understood it with this, that Bhaktisiddhanta saw that in the future everything would be so mixed up that as long as there's one embodiment of Vedic culture that encompasses areas that can be related to from all the different sampradayas, then they can all take shelter there. If that makes sense. Just like sometimes I've understood Srila Prabhupada explaining that Also, and we can see this happening, that especially in the cities, so many people from so many different cultures come, and it all starts to just get mixed up. You know, so the thing is, with Krishna consciousness, it's an amalgamation of all the mix. It's all in there, you know, so people can get everything out of that. Ultimately, once it all gets mixed up so much, then they'll realize that the pure thing that's there is Krishna consciousness. Like that. Someone else had their hand raised. Yes.
Please.
Yeah, in brief, my understanding is that when we have children, according to the Karmakanda, then the children, they would continue to offer sacrifices, in one sense, and those sacrifices would also be offered to the forefathers. So wherever the forefathers go, if the forefathers have gone to Pitriloka, to the planet of the forefathers, then they, in that space, they still can receive the benefits of offerings. Does that make sense? So any offerings that are done here, the forefathers can still receive benefits of it. So it's kind of like, we understand that in the heavenly spheres, that it's like you've got immense credit and you're just burning the credit off, right? You're not necessarily creating bad karma, but you're burning off the good karma there by enjoying, by spending the good credits. So with the Pitris, then they're receiving the benefits that are still happening in the family line, so their good credit is continuing to increase. Does that make sense? Like that. So, but also, is described, I got a quote the other day, but we know from the seventh canto when Lord Nrisimhadev explains to Prahlad Maharaj that simply by him being a pure devotee, that seven generations in the past and seven generations in the future, they all become liberated. So obviously if you can produce one pure devotee in the family, then that's pretty good. For everybody. Makes sense? So you've got that wonderful opportunity. You can do that for your entire family. And they might think you're a crazy kid. But at the end of this, you know, end of this life, when, you know, the Vishnu Dudas take them back to the spiritual realm, they're like, but how am I going there? They're like, because your wonderful son was performing so much pure devotional service that you've now been delivered. They'll be like, wow, we just thought he was wacky, you know? We thought he was wasting his whole life. He just delivered the whole family, you know? You know, 14 generations or 20, somewhere I read it says 100 generations. So, like that, anyway. Okay, we'll stop here. Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki. Ananta Koti Vaishnava Vrinda ki. Grantharaj Srimad Bhagavatam ki. Jai. Okay, so for the pleasure of their lordships, Srila Prabhupada and the assembled Vaishnavas, we have some Sankirtan scores from yesterday. In Closet Krishna. Oh wow, it's a tie. Closet Krishna and Radha's Boutique yesterday. So we'll read Radha's Boutique because they distributed less books. So 106 Lakshmi points, 2 books in Radha's Boutique. Haribo! Drum roll, please. And in Closet Krishna, 106 Lakshmi, 6 medium, 1 Maha big book. Yeah, for 106 Lakshmi points. And yesterday, Govinda's, they had their food stall again at Liverpool Street Station, and they increased. They distributed, doesn't say how many plates of prasadam, but they collected 357 Lakshmi points. And in Govinda's restaurant yesterday, distributing prasadam to at least 306 customers for a total of 2,655 Lakshmi points. And on book distribution yesterday, 6 scores reported, starting with Bhaktin Rosalina, collected 52 Lakshmi points, distributed 25 medium, 4 Mahabig for 20.5 book points. Mother Prabhupada Priya collected 71 Lakshmi points, 100 distributed 115 small books for 28.75 book points. Bhaktavayu Prabhu collected 71 Lakshmi points, distributed 38 medium, 3 big, 4 mahabig for 30 book points. Prananath Prabhu collected 98 Lakshmi points, distributed 10 small, 19 mahabig for 43 book points. Nam Sankirtan Prabhu, 139 Lakshmi points, 10 medium, 1 big, 31 mahabig for 68 book points. And Bhakta Rajesh, collected 206 Lakshmi points, 9 distributed 9 small books, 20 medium books, 5 big books, 39 mahabig books for 95.25 book points. Total of 6 scores, 637 Lakshmi, 124 small, 103 medium, 9 big, 97 mahabig for 285.5 book points. Jai Srila Prabhupada's Transcendental Book Distribution, K. Yeah. Srila Prabhupada, K. Yeah. Wow, it feels like the old days with all that book distribution going on a outside of a sprint. And, of course, yesterday we had ecstatic Harinam all day long. People were rushing, zooming around, the devotees who were chanting the holy names. So, Harinam Sankirtan, K. Yeah. So we'll offer our prayer to their lordships. But first, just wanted to make an announcement. We have one very nice devotee whose birthday it is today, Bhakta Gajan, who is here. Dr. Niranjan and his mother has also come with him today. For the first time, I think, is your visit here? Second time. Wonderful to have you with us, Mother. Thank you so much for coming so early to be with us. So Bhakta Gajan has kindly sponsored today's breakfast and also a cake. For us, so I'd like to thank you very much for that. Hare Krishna. Nice to have you with us. Okay, so we'll offer our prayer to their lordships. And we just need volunteers also to help serve the breakfast prasadam. And on the ladies' side, and volunteers to help clean up the temple room after. Anyone else? Okay. Dear Shishi Radhalanda Nishwar, Jagannath Baladev and Subhadra, Shishi Gorni Thai and Giri Govardhan, we offer our most respectful obeisances unto you. With a mood of deep gratitude and appreciation, we request your causeless mercy upon us. For your pleasure, if you so desire, we wish to erect the holy place of your transcendental pastimes that will attract unlimited souls to your service and fulfill the vision of your pure devotee, Srila Prabhupada, for London. Please enable us to cooperate together in order to satisfy you in this way. We, your surrendered servants, humbly beg. A new temple for the lordships. Ki jai, Srila Prabhupada, ki jai. So if everyone could please help with the prasadam chain to bring the prasadam up from downstairs in the kitchen, be greatly appreciated. Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.